what I want to communicate to you today is my enthusiasm for language and languages, language as a bridge to other people and language as a joy in itself. I grew up in England many years ago and was fortunate in learning, well, first a little German when I was very, very small, but then French very steadily from the age of 7 onwards, very well educated in French, but not traveling to France. I never had any money to travel to France and not really using my French, very bookish French, but I was good at it. But I refused, I defied my school that wanted me to go on with languages and go to Oxford. I wanted to go to Cambridge and I wanted to do mathematics. And I defied them and I managed it and I got to Cambridge and I became a mathematician, then a scientist, not a very good mathematician, a better scientist. And during that period, I kept a promise to myself that I would continue only to read French for pleasure, not other languages. And that meant that while I was studying psychology for 3 years, I was reading the obvious romantic novelists, Stendhal, Flaubert, and reading also poets and Racine, this kind of thing, not science. So I had a scholarly French, a literary French, and an unusable French because I wasn't speaking it. And the war came, and then, for various reasons, we had the chance. I married Peter Milner, a physicist, and we were told we were going with a group of other physicists to Canada, we didn't know where, to begin the study of research on atomic energy. And Peter and I got married. We crossed the Atlantic, still not knowing where we were going to end up. We took the train up from Boston, and lo and behold, I was in Montreal. Now, I had never been out of England, and I had dreamed of a French milieu, of a chance to speak French, and here I was, right there in a French-speaking city. But it got better, because the first job I was offered was at the Université de Montréal, where they were just starting a new department of psychology, and they wanted me to teach experimental psychology and run a lab and teach the psychology of memory in French. Now, this was a triple challenge. First of all, I had never taught. Secondly, I had never really used my French beyond, you know, a few courtesies here and there. And thirdly, my French was literary. I didn't have the vocabulary to teach science in French. So it took me hours to prepare my lectures. But I never hesitated to accept the challenge. In fact, I welcomed it. I was so excited. And I would be teaching there. And the students welcomed me because they had no experimental psychology. It was very clinical at the U of M in those days. And so I taught them what they wanted. And they taught me. They would say, "Madame Milner, do you want to learn a new word?" And I say, "Yes, please, as many new words as possible." And so I got to be part of this. The French became part of my life as I lived it. And it was very enriching. And I have to this day friends from those days where I spend every New Year's Eve with friends that I made during those first years because my students were only about 2 years younger than me. So this was a wonderful start. But I owed it, of course, to having had this very good grounding from the beginning in French, and it made me feel so strongly how useful this was. But, of course, I still hadn't been anywhere. Well, I'd been across the Atlantic, a big distance, but I hadn't yet been into Europe. But a few years passed, I got a little more money, things got easier, and I was even invited to France because of my work here. And there, suddenly, I found such a welcome that people just greet you, you just make a few steps and people greet you. I also discovered, living in this French environment, how one's personality even changes a little, I feel, every time I switch. And of course, I'm switching all the time between French and English. I didn't either tell you that I, as a hobby, late in the war in England, I began to learn Italian. And my Italian was more imperfect in a way, but the Italians were very welcoming. I made Italian colleagues, and one day I arrived in Italy expecting to give a lecture in French because they said that was easier than English. And they said, "Brenda, we have a surprise for you. We decided you're going to lecture in Italian tonight." And from then on, believe it or not, I did. And this has gone on. And so I really believe in languages as as a builder of bridges, as a great joy to oneself. No, but I'm a brain scientist. What do brain scientists have to say about language and about this switching? First of all, this switching that I do all the day, the grocery store, then at the lab and so on, back and forth, English and French. What do they say about it? They say it's very good for the brain. You are using the frontal lobes of the brain to do this kind of switching. It's a kind of multitasking. It doesn't have to be language. In my case, it's language. But it's good for the brain. And what else do you know? You know that if you have Alzheimer. Now, bilingualism is not going to protect you from Alzheimer, unfortunately. But if you have that devastating disease, it can affect the course of it. If you have a bilingual, a multilingual brain, your decline, your inevitable decline with Alzheimer will be slowed. So the message from brain science is that this is a good thing. But now I come back to the reality of today. And why should we, especially in this wonderful city of Montreal, take care of this? It is that we are here with this opportunity. You know, I don't think I would be happy living in a unilingual city anymore. I've been back in my beloved England. In many ways, a wonderful place. But after a while, I say, why is everybody speaking English? I want to hear something else. Of course, you can in London in the streets, but hearing in the streets is not the same thing. I'm very frustrated in the grocery stores because we have now so many people here from Asia, and I hear this melodious up and down sounds where I can't pause at all, and I'm so frustrated. I wish I had that also to excite me. But in this amazing city that invites us, why do we not? And why do you, as the Anglophone part of this city, why do we not go out more and speak more in French? There are many reasons. One is that people are being afraid that they will make a mistake. And something very curious happened last night. Really, this is true. I went home from the rehearsal here, and I got in the elevator in my apartment building, and a gentleman whom I very rarely see because our work times are different, who is a school teacher in the French system, he got on the, and we exchanged greetings, and I said in French, I said, I have been talking about language, I said. And he said, and today I was telling people at the school that children should learn 3 languages before the age of 7 because they are not self-conscious then, they are not afraid of making mistakes. And I said, I'm going to tell them that tomorrow. It really happened last night. And I believe it thoroughly. I was thinking that a lot of people, and one of the problems is that people seem to find English, superficially anyway, easy. So if you're a little hesitant and you're a little scared of speaking French or German or Italian or whatever, the person of the other nationality comes rushing in English. Oh, you don't have to worry about the French. I speak English. And you retreat and you say, wasn't that fine? I did make an effort, but I don't have to try, really. This is wrong. We heard today, as I heard him yesterday, we heard today being told that making mistakes is helpful. Well, psychologists know that we learn by making mistakes. You can, and also in many ways, the speaking of a language is just not learning, not only learning the vocabulary and the syntax, it's actually practicing it. It's a motor skill also. And you know very well you don't improve at sport except by doing it. You're going to come to a plateau and be discouraged unless you actually try to use the language and to make mistakes if you have to. And then the reward, the broadening of your culture, the broadening of your knowledge of yourself is just so amazing. And we here today are so privileged to be in a city where we can do this as often as we want, walking around the streets, whereas other people have to travel in order to have the opportunity to speak another language. So let us profit by our great fortune. And please, let us all go in a Tower of Babel talking as many languages as we can to one another. It's good for our brain, it's good for our happiness, it's good for society. Thank you.